Hey everyone, in this video we're going to take a quick virtual field trip to a location in Japan, which in March of 2011 was the site of a mega thrust earthquake and tsunami. You can see here in this Google Maps view that there is a major oceanic trench here caused by the subduction of the Pacific plate underneath the oceanic plate that Japan is resting on. So you can see the features here where this is relatively shallow and higher in elevation or lower in depth, and this is very deep. So that subduction zone here is constantly moving. This plate is constantly moving this direction toward the west in this case, and being subducted underneath this other major plate. Of course, since it's made of rock, it is resistant to that movement sometimes, and occasionally pressure will build up and will be suddenly released in a major earthquake. In the case of the March 11th, 2011 earthquake, it was called the Tohoku Quake because this region of Honshu, the northern island of Japan, is called Tohoku, and it was felt strongest there, and a tsunami that resulted from it was also felt strongest in this region of Honshu. In the case of this massive movement, there was a magnitude 9.1 earthquake. You can see the epicenter here of that quake is starred, but when an earthquake this large happens, sometimes these are called mega thrust earthquakes because a whole section of the crust moves all at once, and you can see here that the earthquake zone right over that fault scarp was massive, several hundred kilometers long, and the magnitude of that was quite large. So the individual magnitude was a 9.1. This entire zone was at least an 8. The entire zone all the way to the coast was at least a 7.5, which is strong enough shaking to destroy a lot of buildings and cause significant damage to buildings and other structures that aren't completely destroyed. So a massive, massive earthquake because that plate moved suddenly and fairly rapidly. When we talk about the movements here, let's take a look at this model of the plate movements. And this is an exaggerated diagram. This is from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. The previous diagram I just showed you was from the United States Geological Survey. But here is an animation of how this unfolds, and it's drawn not quite to scale because, of course, the distance of continental plates is much greater, but this is a useful illustration for envisioning what happens. So we see tension building up and tension building up, and then finally it releases and that crust snaps back, and when it moves back quickly, it displaces a massive amount of water, which then forms a very large wave that we call a tsunami wave. That tsunami wave, when it comes to the coast, can cause problems. We'll take a look at that context in just a minute. This is from a USGS poster about the same earthquake. And what I just wanted to point out here to you was the reconstructed slip length of the along the fault. And what we see here is that these rectangles are really large, right? So this is 50 kilometers this way, and what's the distance the other way? 100 kilometers the other way, and then we've got 400 kilometers this way and 200. So this total grid is like, what are we looking at here? About 100 kilometers by what's more than 600 kilometers long. And you can see here that there was this massive motion, this massive slip along the fault line. And these red cells show that the seafloor moved 16 to 18 meters. So that is a major motion, right? So 10 meters is about 33 feet. We're looking at somewhere in the 45 to 50 foot range of motion all at once here, dramatic sudden movement of the ocean floor. What that motion, because the faults were not vertical, the faults were horizontal, or a little bit not laying perfectly flat, but because they were at an angle to the sea surface, that massive movement along the fault line translated to a wave of around 10 meters high, around 30 plus feet high. So a massive wave was resulted from this movement along the seafloor. And you can see that the big cells here are that massive movement, but a lot of the ones around there are still 10 meters or larger, right? So this massive area of seafloor, like 200 to 300 kilometers wide by another 200 or so kilometers, or I guess 200 kilometers wide by 300 kilometers long, this massive section of seafloor bumped up, which created not just a tall wave, but a massively large bulge of water. And as that waveform propagated, it hit areas around the Pacific. So there were tsunami effects felt all the way around the Pacific. The wave didn't have that large of an amplitude when it came to like the west coast of the United States, but when it hit Japan, it had some really significant effects, and that's what I wanted to take a minute to show you today. So you can see that this is the coast here of Honshu, right next to where that big waveform happened, and then a lot of the landforms of this coast are embayments that funnel the waves so that the waves gain strength, they gain height as they come into a narrower and narrower embayment. One of the places that was worst hit by that is the town here of Rikuzentakata, and I'm sure I'm not saying it right because my Japanese is not very good, but you can see here that there's this embayment here where the tsunami wave, when it came in, would have been wider, and then as it came through, would have been funneled by the narrowing land until it got higher and higher as it overtook Rikuzentakata. Rikuzentakata was nearly completely leveled by the tsunami. Here's a photo of the remnants of the town. You can see they've actually been cleaning some of it up here, but this is representative of, I think this is right after the devastation. They cleared the road for emergency access, but you can still see the debris everywhere. These are former fields in the background, I believe. If you want to search for more photos of the devastation, you definitely can. This is just one from Wikipedia. I wanted to share one just to show the extent of the devastation. The entire main part of town was leveled. So what I want to show you then is a few videos that I took when I was there that show us about the recovery from this massive tsunami. And I think it's really interesting to point out that the Japanese people here, the people of Rikuzentakata, didn't just go back and rebuild their city where it had been wiped out. They took a lot of time and effort to rebuild the town much, much higher in elevation than it had been. So an unfortunate number of people perished in this accident. It was around 18,000 plus people died in this major tsunami in many different communities. The death toll in Rikuzentakata was one of the higher ones, but it could have been far more if Japan didn't have a warning system in place, and if most people had not heeded the warning, then it would have been a much worse death toll. So there's lessons to be learned from this, and when you watch the videos, you will hopefully get a perspective on some of the aftermath of the devastation. I was there 9 years after the tsunami. I was there in 2020, and they were still rebuilding. And also, I hope the videos give you an appreciation for how much the Japanese are doing to even more prepare for the next one than they had in the previous alarm system they had by building the land differently, building their city back in a different location and with different land uses specified for areas that are at higher risk. I hope you find it interesting. I'll cut to the videos now without any more talking at you with just this photo. The sun is pointing right at the camera, but you can see in the foreground we've got the old youth hostel and the new floodgates in the background. They've built the new floodgate structures, although the floodgates are not complete. So when I started touring the Memorial Museum, they told me about, the first thing they told me was about the evacuation plan. And then there's still lots of construction going on, obviously, here with all the new construction. This is 9 years after the tsunami, they're still doing this construction. The other interesting thing here is this tree called the Miracle Pine Tree. This entire area behind the seawall was covered in a pine forest. You can see the remnants of the destroyed trees. The entire forest was completely wiped out by the tsunami wave. Except for this one tree remains standing. Now, unfortunately, I believe it just passed away, if I understood the museum interpreter correctly, but it's still remarkable that it remains standing. So people come here and use the lone pine tree as a symbol of hope and resilience in the wake of a massive natural disaster like the Tohoku earthquake and tsunami. Okay, here's a different view. The memorial park is over there in the distance. You can see the floodgates in the far distance, barely over there. The seawall, of course, is on the horizon. This is the former site of Rikuzentakata. The area here that used to be some rice fields and then some housing that was completely wiped out. The area over there is being developed into some sports fields. Sports fields are pretty safe because people can get up and evacuate quickly. There's not permanent structures built there in place. You can see they're hardening the channel here for this little stream that drains into the river over there. And this whole area that has already been built up on a big earth pad, you can see they've brought all this material in. They're leveling it. They're putting in streets. This is 9 years after the tsunami, by the way, so these things have taken a ton of time. This area has been zoned as agricultural and commercial only. So buildings are allowed to be put here and will be put here for businesses, but no one will be allowed to live here because of the danger. The position I'm in here is a little higher up, and you can see behind me here, this is a zone that, if you look at the level of the water down there compared to where I am here, this is about 30 feet higher than sea level. So about 10 meters or so, 8 to 10 meters. And this area is considered to be largely safe from all but the worst tsunamis. So this area, you can see there's more commercial development already in place. This was the first part that was built after the tsunami. But if you look further up the hill behind the gas station there, you can see there are communities there that weren't destroyed by the tsunami. And then over here, that area there I drove through earlier is entirely new housing. It's a development that was put in the aftermath of the tsunami when people who had lived here that survived the tsunami decided to build again, but not build on the floodplain of the river in the danger of another tsunami.